Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Resources for the Future and another of our First Wednesday seminars. As you know, this one's entitled Reducing Deforestation in Commodity Supply Chains. As I think most people realize, there are multiple reasons we are concerned about deforestation around the globe, two of the most prominent being biodiversity and the need to use the forest as sinks on the carbon issues that we're all facing. Here at RFF, I just wanted to say a brief word about our work on the climate change part of that. Just to remind you, this is a part of a much broader portfolio that our scholars have been involved in for actually more than two decades, actually, but especially in the last 5 to 10 years. And we have tried, our economists have looked at virtually every major government tool to try to reduce carbon emissions here in the United States and to some degree in other nations as well. But what this is about today is the recognition that there are multiple tools that are not government policy oriented. And this especially becomes, it's important in America, but it's also very important in those parts of the world where government institutions and practices are not as well developed. So you cannot necessarily carry out effective government policies. And here again, a number of our scholars, particularly led by Dr. Alan Blackman, have been doing research on a variety of these kind of questions in the developing world, including the one that is before us today, focusing on, in a sense, non-government tools for reshaping these markets and practices and behaviors that are relevant to forestation in particular. Let me quickly say, we, in addition to that, RFF, and again, it's partly led by Dr. Blackman, is engaged in an international cooperative, or collaborative, I should say, of a network of scholars around the world, and who are in particular in developing nations. It's called Environment for Development. The collection you'll see on our website, the papers that arrive out of this collective group of people around the world, and is to try to enhance the capacity in many of these nations so that they have domestic folks who are doing the same kinds of work that we try to do here at RFF to help improve policy making by governments, and in this case, reaching beyond government policy. Well, with that brief introduction, let me turn it over to Dr. Blackman, who is one of our top scholars, a senior fellow here, who is highly respected and well known in his field in the economics of development. And I'm delighted that he'll explain more specifically how these issues are going to arise.
Thanks, Phil. Good afternoon. Thanks a lot for coming. So we have a great group of six panelists here today that represents some of the, I think, most exciting and important initiatives dealing with supply chain deforestation. And I'm going to get to the main event, which is those speakers fairly quickly. So I'm going to keep my remarks brief. I'd just like to do three quick things before I bring the panelists up. The first one is to kind of set the stage by telling you a little bit about the nature of the problem that we're going to be talking about today, about the magnitude of the problem and some of the policies that are used to address it. Then I'm going to give a brief plug for some related research that we're doing here at Resources for the Future. And then I'll introduce the panelists. And then each of the panelists are going to have 8 minutes, a brief amount of time, to talk about their initiatives and their work. And then we'll have hopefully 15 or 20 minutes at the end for audience participation for questions and answers. For folks that are joining us online, please tweet us any questions you may have using hashtag AskRFF. So with that, just getting into a bit of background. So as you know, tropical deforestation remains a very significant problem. According to the Global Forest Watch, which Crystal Davis, one of our panelists, is going to be talking to us about in a minute, over the last decade, or more precisely from 2004 to 2015, the average rate of tropical deforestation was about 10 million hectares per year. So that means the loss of an area approximately the size of Indiana each year over the last 10 years. And that deforestation, along with forest degradation, has all kinds of nasty environmental consequences at the global level and at the local level. So at the global level, as Phil just mentioned, it's a leading cause of emissions of greenhouse gases that cause global warming. It's a leading cause of biodiversity loss. At the local level, it's associated with soil erosion and the loss of hydrological services and the loss of other valuable forest ecosystem services. So it's now there's a consensus that the leading driver of tropical deforestation is conversion of forests for agriculture and ranching. So according to a Forest Trends report that came out at the end of 2014, 71% of tropical deforestation in the preceding decade was associated with agriculture and in particular commercial agriculture. And as you probably know, there are four commodities that are the main culprits, and those commodities are soy, wood products, timber and pulp and paper, palm oil, and cattle. So these four, which are called the big four, you may know are ubiquitous. So they're found everywhere. So some of you may have seen an article that came out about 3 weeks ago in the Washington Post in the Outlook section by Ali Goldstein. I don't know Ali. I think I see her sitting in the audience. but thank you for writing an article that serves as a great motivation for our panel today. So the title of that article was Almost Everything You Buy from Cereal to Mascara is Killing the Rainforest. So I tried to give it up. It was almost impossible. So Ali thought it would be an interesting experiment to try and eliminate from her shopping list all items that had one of these big four commodities in them or associated with them. And as the title says, she found it almost impossible. It's interesting reading. So she gave up buying stuff that had cardboard packaging because she couldn't be sure that the cardboard was sourced from wood from a sustainably managed forest. She had to give up eating most meat because most meat is raised using soy-based animal feed. And then there's a lot of products that I didn't realize have soy in them, like makeup and hand lotions and soap and detergent. So again, these big four commodities really suffuse our supply chains. So what policy options do we have for doing something about the problem? Well, the seemingly most straightforward solution would be to try to motivate regulatory agencies in tropical countries to enforce land use and land cover change restrictions, which in most cases are already on the books. But that's problematic for a number of fairly obvious reasons. Often there's a lack of political will to do that because there's a need to prioritize economic development and poverty alleviation. Often regulatory institutions are undermanned and underfunded. And it's just a daunting prospect to try and monitor and enforce thousands of often small-scale producers of these agricultural commodities. So increasingly, over the last couple of decades, we've seen policymakers turn to what are often referred to as demand-side policies. So these are policies that are spearheaded by the actors that are demanding these commodities associated with deforestation. So these are countries, their companies, their consumers. And I have here just a list of some of the most prominent of these demand-side policies. So there's eco-certification that typically involves an NGO or a multi-stakeholder group setting environmental production standards and then certifying producers that meet those standards. There are corporate commitments. These are voluntary commitments made by corporations to try and reduce deforestation in their supply chains. There are public-private partnerships, which as the name indicates, are partnerships between public sector and private sector actors to promote actions that reduce supply chain deforestation. There's moratoria, which involves private sector actors, typically large traders, committing to not trading with producers that are associated with deforestation. There are public sector interventions like the Lacey Act, which prohibits the import in the United States of wood and wood products that are sourced from illegally. And then there's consumer activism, basically NGOs organizing boycotts and advertising campaigns. So those are the policies that our panelists are going to be talking about today, those demand-side policies. Before I get to the panelists, I just want to, as I said, put a plug in for some related research we're doing here at Resources for the Future. A key theme of this research is rigorously evaluating the effectiveness of these demand-side policies. So one thread of that research uses satellite data, remote sensing data, to evaluate the impact on forest cover change of forest certification, FSC certification. So we've got a study looking at that issue in Mexico and one looking at it in northern Guatemala. Another thread of this research looks at coffee certification, the environmental benefits of coffee certification. So we've got one of those studies in Costa Rica and another one in Colombia. And finally, we're doing a lot of work right now looking at the effect on forest cover change of providing formal legal title to forests to indigenous communities in South America. So we've got studies in Peru, Bolivia, Colombia, and in Ecuador. Finally, we're developing for NASA a couple of web-based tools to support forest conservation policymaking, initially focused on Latin America. So one of these tools is meant to try and help policymakers figure out where to cite forest conservation policies to generate the greatest bang for the buck. And the other tool is meant to help policymakers rigorously evaluate the impact of those policies. And both of those tools are scheduled to be launched and publicly available this summer. So that's my advertisement for RFF. And now I'd like to introduce our panel. So we have, as I said, a great panel, very accomplished, and I could spend at least a half an hour describing the panelists. But in lieu of that, in the interest of time, I'll just refer you to the bio sketches, which should be on the table or chairs. And I'm just going to make very brief introductions, and I'll go through the folks in the order that they're going to present, which is different than the order that they're listed on the sheets that you have. So our first panelist is Christine Dragasic, who is a Foreign Affairs Officer and the Red Plus focal point at the U.S. Department of State. And Chris is going to be talking to us about the Tropical Forest Alliance, which is one of the most prominent public-private partnerships focusing on supply chain deforestation, as well as a number of other activities in which the U.S. government is involved on this issue. Second panelist is Mark Murphy. Mark is the Global Head of Corporate Responsibility and Sustainability at Cargill, which, as you know, is one of the world's largest companies dealing in the trade of agricultural commodities. And Mark is going to be talking to us about Cargill's voluntary corporate commitments to reduce supply chain deforestation. The third panelist is Steve D'Onofrio, who is a senior advisor to Supply Change, which is a project of the Forest Trends Ecosystem Marketplace. And he's going to be talking to us about that initiative, which focuses on monitoring and cataloging voluntary corporate commitments. The next panelist is Jeff Milder, who is the lead scientist for evaluation and research at Rainforest Alliance. Rainforest Alliance, as you know, is one of the leading global environmental non-governmental organizations. And Jeff is going to be talking to us about Rainforest Alliance's activities focused on voluntary corporate commitments and potentially on eco-certification as well. The next panelist is Crystal Davis, who's the director of the Global Forest Watch at World Resources Institute. The Global Forest Watch, as you know, is a web platform for remotely sensed and crowdsourced forest cover change data that's really changing how we monitor tropical deforestation and how we our ability to monitor the effectiveness of policies meant to stem it. And last but not least is Mike Willosen, who's the president of Forest Climate Analytics and also a visiting scholar at Resources for the Future. Mike was one of the folks that was involved in setting up the Tropical Forest Alliance and also in the New York Declaration of Forests. And he's going to be offering some general reflections on the opportunities and challenges of using the types of policies that we're talking about today. So again, if you're online and you're interested in submitting a question, you can tweet it to us at hashtag AskRFF. And we, again, have 8 minutes for each of our panelists, and my colleague Elaine here is going to be our enforcer. I'd ask you to please try and keep to the time limit since we have six folks to get through. With that, I'd like to bring up our first presenter, Christine. Thanks.
Hi, everybody. Good afternoon. It's really nice to see so many people who are actually interested in talking about commodities and deforestation here in one place. It's especially nice because there's another forum going on just across town looking at very similar issues, the Innovation Forum focused on deforestation. I think there was a third meeting focusing on food policy and links to deforestation just an hour ago. So there's a lot of brain power being put behind this issue. I've been asked to talk about the Tropical Forest Alliance 2020, which is something that the United States government and the Consumer Goods Forum launched in 2012 at Rio Plus 20. The TFA 2020 was launched with the objective of reducing the impact of commodity production on deforestation, and with the idea that no one actor has figured out how to solve this problem alone. Governments couldn't do it alone, the private sector couldn't do it alone, civil society couldn't do it alone. And so TFA 2020 brought all of those together into one space. TFA 2020 decided from the start to focus on the four commodities that Alan mentioned earlier, beef, palm oil, pulp and paper, and soy, with the understanding that those had the largest impact on tropical deforestation. And it looked at how these different actors could come together under one umbrella to cooperate in different patterns, different groups, to help address issues related to deforestation. It's been a learning process, to be very honest. I've been involved in it from before the launch, and we've seen it grow from two partners to 70, which is amazing. The first global assembly was 2 weeks ago in Jakarta. We saw for the first time everybody coming together in one space, and it was a huge opportunity to present what is going on, and then to think about what we can do together. And that really is the power of TFA 2020 and a coalition of 70 very diverse actors. That part of the work, which I think personally is the most interesting, is really incipient. There are a lot of things that we can do together, but how you harness the scale of such different actors in such different places is something that the group as a whole is working through. And I think it's been a process of building trust, of building relationships, of understanding what people are doing, and now you're starting to see work emerge together. A couple of really interesting things were talked about in Jakarta, and a number of people in this room were involved in those meetings and can probably provide more details. But one is something called the Africa Palm Oil Initiative, where you had a number of West African governments working with companies, working with civil society, to look at standards for the production of palm oil in their countries, social standards, environmental standards, economic standards. And this is a coalition that's come together in each of these countries, country-led, to look at how they think palm oil should be done well, learning from the experience of other regions. And that's an area where TFA 2020's members coming together, I think, can really have an impact. There's another set of work that's looking at how this set of members can help resolve some of the financing issues that are behind the need to shift commodity supply chains. How do you actually get finance to where it's needed? How do you deal with scale when you have tens of thousands of smallholders, many of whom don't have access to credit? What else do you need to finance in a landscape in order to create the right enabling environment for good land use, for sound land use, and for market access? So this is something that TFA 2020 is beginning to look at. It's an area where we think this broad coalition can come together and really begin to have an impact. It's going to be an evolving process. It's going to be something that I think becomes more effective over time as we figure out how to do this. But you're starting to see, I think, the seeds of what can be very impactful when you put together all of these different actors with all of these different interests around a common goal. TFA 2020 was started not only with the intention of working together, but also as an umbrella for all the different types of actions individual partners are taking with different members towards those objectives of reducing deforestation associated with commodity supply chains. So I wanted to focus on some of the other things the U.S. government is involved in partnership with other TFA 2020 members and other partners as we look at reducing the impact of commodity supply chains on deforestation. USAID, our partners across town, have a huge amount of work going on public-private partnerships through something called the Global Development Alliance, where there's work with very large companies in tropical partner countries to help them shift supply chains on the ground. And some of those are in countries where you've seen less government engagement to date, but now with this new mechanism and with some pretty large partnerships on the ground, we're beginning to see some good inroads into sourcing and into government interest in addressing the deforestation. USAID does a lot of work with partners on smallholder engagement and especially on improving commodity yields from smallholder farmers in places like Indonesia, working with palm oil, and across the globe. In West Africa, there's a number of good initiatives as well. USAID and our ambassador in Indonesia have been keenly involved in things like the Indonesia Palm Oil Pledge, where you have some of the largest palm oil companies committing not to clear forest, to work well with smallholders, and to improve their impact on the environment and their sourcing. We at the Department of State have not actually been sitting in our offices here in Washington. We've also been out engaging in these issues. Two things that we've worked on were the creation of a large global initiative called the Biocarbon Fund Initiative for Sustainable Forest Landscapes that brings together both forests and agricultural areas in one single landscape. It looks at how you provide big grants to countries to improve the enabling environments to do things like land tenure reform, policy reform, infrastructure development. It will have a payment for performance component. So as these big jurisdictions begin to reduce emissions across the whole landscape, forests and agriculture, they will be paid. And it brings in from the beginning the involvement of the private sector through sourcing commitments, through financing plans, through capacity building and extension services. So ISFL is working in four countries to start. We hope it'll grow from there. But it was pioneering integrated land use and public-private partnerships at that scale. And most recently, we've been working with a number of companies who are looking to implement their sourcing commitments, their deforestation-free sourcing commitments, in the same regions that are implementing these big forest and climate programs, these big Red Plus programs. So you'll have governments like ours supporting very interested forest country governments in reducing deforestation. They're putting in place the enabling environments, the institutions, the systems, the monitoring systems that you need to actually reduce deforestation, track those results. And you're having companies say, because those are now better places to work, because our risk is lower and our costs are lower, we're looking to source in those areas. For the governments now, the sourcing of commodities becomes an additional incentive for doing the right thing. And it's an additional reason that their stakeholders on the ground are rewarded for actually looking at reducing emissions across the landscape. So as I wrap up, two things I think to take away. One is that the only way we will begin to address deforestation, the only way Red Plus will be successful on the ground, is if we throw every tool we have at this issue. And those tools involve governments, but they also involve commodity sourcing, changing how we source. They involve changing how we finance big projects, changing how money flows writ large. And that requires the types of coalitions that you see under the TFA 2020, and it requires a lot of the emerging partnerships that you're starting to see on the ground. The other thing that I'll leave you with, and this goes back to a discussion I had earlier this morning, is that this is actually starting to happen, and we're starting to see results in places. Not yet at the scale most of us hoped a couple of years ago. It's slow, it's difficult, but you're actually starting to see this become real. And I think for most of us who care about these issues, that's pretty exciting.
Mark, yeah. Next speaker?
Do you want me up there?
Yes, please. Thanks.
I wasn't looking at my...
No problem.
So, like Christine, I'm happy to be here, and I'm happy to see that there's so much interest in deforestation and commodity, responsible supply chains and commodities. going on in Washington today. I'm going to go back to 2004 in Cargill, 2003-2004. We were having a conversation, a global business, conversation about a Brazil business, learning that they were building a new export facility in Santarém, Brazil, which is right in the middle of the Amazon River. And the purpose of the grain facility is to haul grain out of Brazil, the center of Brazil, down a river, the top of the coast, to the Amazon, so you can ship it to places like Europe and Asia and save 2 days of transportation time and cost. Economically makes a lot of sense. But we were getting a lot of noise. There were a lot of activism going on because why do you put a big facility in the middle of the Amazon? The Amazon was raging with deforestation at the time. And we heard that the Nature Conservancy, which had been a long-standing, you know, charitable gifts partner of Cargill, was working there on the ground. And so I had the job because I had been working with the Nature Conservancy in the U.S. to call. And I called up this guy named David Clary. And for those of you who may know David Clary, he's this sort of brash, friendly, very candid, very direct Brit that has been based in Brazil a long time. And I call him up and doing my public relations thing that you would do in a corporation and say, well, we work with the Nature Conservancy. What's this all about? And he goes, he very frankly said, well, I don't know how nice you guys, I don't care how nice you guys are or how committed you are to doing good, but you are the poster child for deforestation in the Amazon, and you better start paying attention. And that caught my attention, and it caught the attention of a lot of other people. And we began working with the Nature Conservancy on the ground in that area with farmers to begin to learn more about the issues and better understand and help our business understand that it wasn't just about two-day economics to getting grain out, but it was about the whole complex. Fast forward 2 more years, and even though we were working with the Nature Conservancy and working with a small cohort of farmers on more responsible sourcing and to comply with a forest code that wasn't really gaining much attention at the time in Brazil, but had been around since 1964. Actually, I was on vacation standing at the turnstile, and I got a phone call, and Greenpeace had just put out a report. Chickens had invaded, live human chickens had invaded all the restaurants in France at McDonald's. And McDonald's was being told that they had to get soybeans from Brazil out of their supply chain, and it was Cargill that was causing it. McDonald's is our, if not our biggest, one of our biggest customers. And, you know, within 2 minutes, the bat phone rang, and things began to happen between McDonald's and Cargill. We were working with multiple NGOs, Greenpeace, and others for several weeks, and later in 2006, the moratorium, the soy moratorium, was formed with a collaboration led by industry, Greenpeace, McDonald's, some other NGOs, and so started a journey. About that same time, Cargill, who had one palm plantation in Indonesia, decided to buy 3 or 4 more in a big deal, and a couple in Papua New Guinea and a couple in Indonesia. And again, we were sort of like, well, what's palm oil all about? And the RSPO was just beginning, the round table on sustainable palm oil was just getting formed. And so again, in another part of the world, in a totally different business, again, the specter of the complexities around commodity supply chains in tropical areas and tropical forests came up. And so front and center, we were right in ground zero of these very large issues that were driving deforestation. Very different supply chains. So I tell that story because it's been a long journey. It still is a long journey. We're still at the very beginning. The soy moratorium in Brazil has had a rocky future, a rocky past, I would say, but it's had great success. Industry, NGOs, civil society, getting the government to ratchet up its enforcement capabilities on the Brazil Forest Code have all contributed to a major reduction in deforestation in the Amazon. There are still lots of issues. This is all in the soy sector. Still lots of issues. In Indonesia, the palm oil, the roundtable on responsible palm oil has generated lots of members to come in and begin a certification process, but there are lots of gaps. So Cargill has been on this journey for a long time. How do we engage farmers? How do we engage stakeholders? How do we really get traction when you're working with virtually thousands of farmers? It's about engaging the suppliers, engaging the producers. It's about smallholder training. It's about community engagement. It's about figuring out systems for traceability and transparency, being more direct. It's about partnership. We partner with WRI, and you'll hear from Kristen in a minute. We partner with TNC. We partner with TFA. We partner with Tropical Forest Trust. All of these provide services to us and help us. We partner with ProForest. These are all organizations that provide counsel and help to us as our different businesses engage. Every supply chain is different. There's a great amount of complexity. We find ourselves involved in a whole lot of initiatives that are out there. Good initiatives, well-meaning initiatives, but there's a whole lot of redundancy. The COP21, the commitments we made at the climate summit 2 years ago about deforestation, eradicating deforestation from our supply chains by 2020, all by 2030, are all very good. But we are not making the progress yet that we're making. We're still at the tip of the iceberg. We need to have more, greater collective action, and think about how we can have more collective results, and think about what we can do more in the pre-competitive space to have certain data, certain information, maps like WRI, Global Forest Watch, in the public domain, so there's more transparency and a more even playing field so that we can really focus on doing the operations part of really sourcing and originating and not spending our time weeding through hundreds of metrics and indicators that everybody else has for their own. I will stop there because I know there'll be lots of questions, but that gives you a flavor of the complexity that we're dealing with. Thank you.
Stephen? Now you can start timing me. Look, thanks very much to RFF for inviting us to speak here today, and thank, this is a great room. It's completely packed, which is fantastic. So let me just quickly tell you a bit about forest trends and supply chains, why we're doing what we're doing, and then I'm gonna try in this 8 minutes to give you a quick walkthrough of the website. It's a really useful tool, it's powerful. There's a lot of information there, and I really wanna know more about the folks in the room and how we can further develop the tool so that it can be of use to you. So feel free to come up to me afterwards and let me know and how we can help you with the data, how we can help you with using it. So let me just quickly start off. Forest Trends is a nonprofit organization based here in Washington, D.C. Supply Change is a project of Forest Trends. We have two very important partners, the Carbon Disclosure Project, now CDP, and WWF. So when looking at why we're partnering with these organizations and what we're doing in the context of these issues that we're talking about here today in terms of deforestation, the value chains of corporate commodities, what needs to happen is transparency, but what that transparency is telling us is what are companies committing to related to zero deforestation, and then what are they reporting annually or on a regular enough basis to be able to track that progress over time. And when we started looking at this about 2 years ago, or maybe about 2.5 years ago, but when we started really getting our feet wet in this, we found that the information was very disaggregated. Companies were reporting into the Carbon Disclosure Project, into their sustainability reports, company websites, into various roundtables that are set up to help companies set certification goals and various commitments for commodities. And so we wanted to pull all of that together and make it really easy for companies and their stakeholders, including investors, their employees, their customers, to quickly be able to access that information. So that's what we've put together on supply-change.org. And we started off when we launched with just around 25 or so companies. And now we have over 350 companies profiled on the website. And we've researched 800 entities. And we have an ongoing process for doing this desk research. So what's unique is that we're not asking companies to report additional information to us, but we're collecting it from what's already publicly available. And the second part is we're not passing any judgments. So there are a lot of scorecards out there, a lot of ranking systems set up for this.
but we're not taking that upon ourselves to assess the quality or of the rigor of any of the company's commitments or the actions that they're taking. We're allowing the stakeholders to do that themselves. So go to supply-change.org when you have a chance, put it into your phone as a link. There is a web version or an app version, a phone version of that website. So just a few quick things up here. So the commodities that we've been talking about today, the four key ones are the ones that we've focused on. There are a lot of other ones, including rubber and sugar and others that we can in the future, but we've decided to focus on these four first. The website is full of helpful resources and the news and resources section. We have a team that is just compiling all that information, making it available. We have released two reports as of today. And we have another one coming out in June, and that's a follow-up to our initial findings report that we launched back in March of last year. So that's kind of covers what we try to produce with this. I mean, the website and the research and the articles. Now talking about what are we talking about when it comes to commitments? What are companies actually saying, and how are we trying to reproduce that onto the website? So if you look at this screen here, if it's too small, I'd be happy to make these slides available to you later. But we're looking at things like, what is the commodity that the company is focusing on? Are they focusing on multiple commodities? If so, how can we break that out? We're also looking at the scope. So is it their own brands? Is it their own operations? Or are they looking at how they're engaging with their suppliers? And then when we think about targets, those are things like zero, zero growth, zero net deforestation, peatland protection, HCV, HCS, sustainable responsible sourcing, and human rights protection. But then we need to know the bounds of that. So what is the timeline? When are companies setting that target, and when are they aiming to achieve it? And then how they report each year. We have a six-month rolling research refresh process on these company profiles. So we're trying to keep it as up-to-date as possible. And so how are they reporting those milestones and the general progress? But then there's all these other procurement policy elements or production policy elements like certification and transparency and various other aspects that go into that overarching commitment that we track and we provide for each of the companies in their profile. And then we have a whole list of other metrics that we're going to start collecting and start adding to those profiles. And those things include waste and water. Okay, so got a little bit of time. Does anybody have a company that they're interested in seeing? And just think about it as I continue to go through and blurt it out. If you have one. You okay with that?
You know what we talked about.
All right. Well, why don't we'll do Cargill quickly, and I'll show you the quick preview of Cargill. So this is, if you were to just quickly type in Cargill, you'd see a quick view of their screen. And what you can do is cycle through the commodities that they've reported information on related to their commitment. And we've tried to synthesize that information down into a simple screen. Let's take a look at Walmart real quick. And if we were going to full profile of Walmart, I want to just highlight a few aspects of this profile. And I know you might not be able to see it very clearly, but the top portion, and if you're trying to think about the stakeholders that we're trying to produce this for, investors, companies themselves, NGOs, government, any stakeholder that's generally interested in this. So things like the stock ticker, if they're a publicly held company, but related activities. So how do you try to gauge a company's commitment to their commitment? Are they involved in any organizations like the TFA or CGF? Are they reporting to CDP? They're part of the Sustainable Apparel Coalition, various others. And as I mentioned, we're not doing any scoring of companies. So what we do instead is in this relevance assessments area, we reproduce the scores that the company has received by other third parties that have done their own scoring and ranking. And then if you were to go down the page and take a look at what the company is said is their commitment, that shows up in that big green circle there. And so you can go there, see what the commitment is. If you wanted to, you could pull up multiple companies on different screens and try to match them up and see if there are any characteristics that line up. I mean, a really important thing about going through this process is that we find very few companies have a consistent, identical commitment. And even further is very few companies have a consistent commitment and also consistent procurement policy or production policy elements. So these things start to, you know, come to light when you go through this process. And other important metrics that we want to try to collect are things about volume. So how much is the company consuming or producing of that commodity, and how much of that is related to their commitment? And as much as we can gather that information, if it's publicly available, we produce it. And so then when you take a look at this, you see this bar chart, and it shows you the progress that they're reporting over time, and it shows you the commitment criteria that I showed on that little box on the initial slides. And so what we aim to do is, and I'll close in just a second, but what we aim to do is provide all of the resources that we use to create these profiles onto this page. So we've completely simplified the process for anybody interested in looking at this, the company's information, because we've put it all back here for you. So it's all there, all available. Like I said, we update it on a regular process. We have some very important partners that work with us. We've been doing some work with the Consumer Goods Forum and various other entities. So we're really interested at this stage, now that we've hit this very critical mass of companies, 350 plus companies, entities profiled, that we can start to get this information out of our database and further into the use of other organizations that may be doing something similar, so we can help create efficiency of work for other organizations. But we also want to make sure that we can be a tool that is integrated into other organizations. So let us know how we can help you, and thanks very much for the opportunity to present today. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Stephen. Next speaker is Jeff Milder from Rainforest Alliance.
Great. Well, first of all, thanks to Resources for the Future for convening this very timely symposium and inviting Rainforest Alliance to participate. I think Alan assumed I was going to speak about certification because that's what Rainforest Alliance is best known for. I'm sorry to disappoint. I'd actually like to speak about voluntary corporate commitments and really build on some of the remarks that both Mark and Stephen made, and talk about the state of play in the implementation of these commitments. So you're a company, you've made a commitment to halt deforestation, maybe to address social conflict in your supply chain and do other things like that. What next? You assess your exposure, you take action, you document performance. How do you do that? Many companies are using certification programs to do this to some extent. But when it comes to cementing the link between policy commitments, action, and documented results, there's very little outside of existing certification programs in the way of commonly accepted norms or tools or guidelines about how to evaluate, verify, report, and communicate about progress, about results. So what I'm talking about really is, what are the source data on performance that, say, would feed a tool like supply change? How do we know what's actually going on the ground? Instead, a multitude of approaches is springing up. Companies are developing their own methods. They're working with different partners or service providers to help them do so. And while this process has spurred a lot of ideas and innovation, it's also created a lot of noise. And this lack of coherence has created a situation where good actors don't necessarily have clear guidance on how to proceed, while bad actors might be able to hide between statements of intent or token actions that are not necessarily driving change. So I want to unpack the nature of what we perceive as an implementation gap, and then suggest maybe some steps that could be taken to help close it in terms of how these sustainability commitments translate into progress on the ground. So gap number one is in the area of definitions. In this space of corporate commitments, as Stephen alluded to, there's many different terms that are used: zero deforestation, zero net deforestation. These terms don't mean the same things when used by different companies. There's nuances of meaning that are all critical for how these are played out on the ground. Gap number two, norms for credible verification and assurance. If a company wishes to demonstrate that it's adhered to its policy commitment and isn't doing so through an established certification program, what are its options? How independent does an assessment need to be? What is the role of first, second, and third party assessments? How can progress in a supply chain be evaluated using risk-based approaches? A third gap is the development of common indicators, measurement, and monitoring protocols. So to the extent that commitments are referencing the same concepts or terms, such as forest loss or such as free prior informed consent of local communities, should there not be some common indicators for evaluating whether these have been carried out? A fourth gap is traceability. There's widespread agreement that there needs to be more visibility in the different levels of a value chain, but this isn't always entirely feasible or realistic in the case, for instance, of certain palm oil derivatives. What is a realistic expectation for commitments for companies that have committed to traceability? Norms for reporting and disclosure. So in the vein of transparency, what is the expectation for companies at different levels of the value chain to be reporting on performance? And finally, norms for claims and communication. So where progress has been made, what kinds of claims can a company legitimately make? Is there a way to standardize the language around that a little bit so that we can understand where progress is being made and reduce the risk of greenwashing? So that's quite a list of gaps, and I think it underscores that collectively there's quite a bit of work still to do in translating these statements of intent into action on the ground. But I don't want to end on a pessimistic note. So in the remainder of my time, I'd like to share the example of some work that Rainforest Alliance did last year to address some of these implementation gaps in the context of one company, Asia Pulp and Paper. Some of you may have heard of APNP, or APP. This is a company that has had a checkered past in terms of forest destruction, social conflict, and other irresponsible practices. But in early 2013, they issued a forest conservation policy committing to no deforestation and other responsible practices. And they began right away to implement this policy. And a year later, they asked Rainforest Alliance to come in and evaluate whether they had been implementing this policy effectively during their first 18 months. For us, it was a big decision whether to take on this assignment, but ultimately the decision was a principled one and reflects the way that Rainforest Alliance is increasingly working with companies outside the context of the certification programs that we've long supported and endorsed, such as the FSC. Our bottom line was that if this work could be a way of driving real change on the ground, that we would do it. And we did this by requiring APP to agree to some basic terms of engagement to make sure that the assessment would be technically sound, credible, and transparent. And in doing so, essentially, we had to close some of these implementation gaps in the context of working with APP. The first thing we did was to develop a verification framework, essentially translating the forest conservation policy, a very high-level policy document, into a set of auditable indicators. So how do we determine whether free prior informed consent has been implemented? How do we measure forest loss? And we subjected this framework to two rounds of public consultation. Second, we developed an explicit assessment methodology based on the auditing principle of triangulation, so cross-checking between document review, interviews, and field observation, and insisting that the company would afford us access to these different sources of information. We also required that the findings of the assessment would be public in the vein of transparency. And finally, we established upfront clear guidelines about how the company would communicate and make claims about any findings to make sure that there was honest communication and not greenwashing. In the end, the assessment found that the company was making reasonable progress. They still had some work to do. For instance, they'd managed to halt forest clearance among their direct suppliers, but there was still forest clearance in their catchment due to, for instance, illegal logging or conflicting tenure issues that they hadn't been able to resolve. They'd mapped social conflicts across their supply chain and begun addressing those, but the conflicts were not yet resolved. And all of this information, this assessment, is publicly available on our website. By following this very explicit and transparent process, we were able to produce an assessment and in the end largely satisfied APP, as well as the watchdog NGOs and the stakeholders who were exerting really intense scrutiny on the company. So I use this example to suggest how some of these implementation gaps can be closed by developing very clear norms and guidelines on things like evaluation, verification, reporting, and communications. The next step, I believe, is to move from individual one-off development of these tools to doing so in a more generalized way that can apply to these commitments more broadly, allowing us to move from the current situation, which is fairly chaotic, to one where there's a greater level of consistency and quality in the implementation of these commitments. If we do so, I think we stand a much better chance of having these commitments translate to real positive change on the ground. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Jeff. The next speaker is Crystal Davis from WRI.
All right. I am not going to spend any more time thanking everyone, not because I don't love you, but because I have a very ambitious plan for the next 8 minutes. As we all know, satellites and computers have radically transformed the way that we understand the world around us. And not only is this technology rapidly improving, resulting in higher resolution imagery and more frequent updates, but it's also becoming easier and easier for the average person to be able to access and understand this information from their computers and their mobile phones. Global Forest Watch launched 2 years ago with the aim of bringing this technology and transparency revolution to bear on forest landscapes, and particularly for the benefit of those many stakeholders who have long been trying to manage and protect forests with very limited and often low quality information at their disposal. Historically, when we wanted to monitor forests, we had to put people on the ground. So it's a very time intensive and costly process. And at the end of the day, our knowledge is really limited to sort of tabular statistical data, often at the national level, or very coarse resolution global maps that are produced in these very heavy reports that are, you know, very irregularly and infrequently updated. Global Forest Watch changed all of this 2 years ago by introducing for the first time near real time and high resolution monitoring of tree cover loss at a global scale. And we did this by taking advantage of freely available satellite imagery, very advanced machine learning algorithms, and the massive cloud computing power of Google. And the really breakthrough thing about Global Forest Watch, I think, is that we're providing global coverage in our monitoring, but it's also locally precise and relevant information. So we can zoom in on Peru, and you can see logging roads snaking through the Amazon rainforest. You could zoom in on Indonesia, and you could see forests being cleared to make way for new oil palm plantations. All of these images were captured in the last year. After we launched Global Forest Watch 2 years ago, we started having conversations with companies in the Consumer Goods Forum and stakeholders to the TFA 2020 process to try to figure out how we can take Global Forest Watch technology and apply it to the challenge of monitoring deforestation within global commodity supply chains, and in particular, to be able to demonstrate progress towards these very ambitious zero deforestation commitments. So those conversations ended up resulting in us launching the Global Forest Watch Commodities platform, which is a free online tool currently in a beta version, and I'll have a link at the end of the presentation. We start with the core monitoring technology of Global Forest Watch, and then we layer on additional maps that provide deeper context about the existing landscape. So what is the land cover, land use, land tenure dynamics on the ground? And then finally, we layer on the business context. Where are the concessions in the production areas? Where are the processing facilities? Which ones of these are certified? And then we take all this information and we translate it into a set of practical analytical tools that help companies and other interested stakeholders to be able to quantify impacts, identify risks, and ultimately understand the actors and drivers associated with deforestation in their supply chains. And we've been working with a number of companies, including Cargill, to both build out and test these tools on the ground. So just to give you a sense of what this looks like, these are just some screenshots from the GFW Commodities web tool. Here we're zooming in, using the interactive map to zoom in on Indonesia, and we can see cumulative tree cover loss since 2001 in pink. And then in yellow, you can see oil palm concessions. If we click on one of the concessions, we can see which company owns that concession. And then we can start contextualizing this information with additional map layers. So here I pulled up legal land use classifications in Indonesia. So you can see in dark green, protected area, and perhaps of concern, we can see the protected area is overlapping with the concession on its northern boundary. And once we've zoomed in on our area of interest and identified the map layers we're interested in, we can subscribe to alerts for that area. So if you put in your email address, we'll let you know anytime we detect new tree cover loss or new fire activity. And you can also carry out a custom analysis on that area. So you pick the indicators that you're interested in, and then with the click of a button, you have a report showing the key statistics for that area in a graphical format. We're constantly working to bring new data into the system. So very recently, we launched the first public-facing global palm oil mill database. Working together with the Traceability Working Group and Known Sources, we combined previously privately held mill data from various companies and published it as a public global map of over 800 mill locations. And we're constantly working to grow this database as more companies are sharing their mill data with us. And why is this information useful to have? A lot of companies have made progress in the palm oil sector tracing back to the mill level, but not necessarily to the farm level. So working with Diameter and ProForest, we've created the Palm Oil Mill Risk Assessment Tool. And this palm tool allows companies who are buying palm oil to be able to understand which mills have the highest risk of deforestation within their supply shed. So they can then prioritize those high-risk suppliers rather than trying to exclude them for follow-up action. And the tool allows you to zoom in on an individual mill to understand deforestation risk within that supply chain, but then you can also look at relative risk rankings across a set of mills. And looking at that data in tabular format, we can understand different mills and compare them with respect to their historic deforestation behavior, as well as future potential for forest loss. And then you can drill down even deeper and understand deforestation dynamics across various environmental indicators, so you can start developing mill-specific risk mitigation plans. So that was a very quick and dirty introduction to Global Forest Watch and the Global Forest Watch Commodities Tools, and I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the challenges and opportunities that we still face as we try to monitor deforestation in these supply chains. And I will note that Jeff and I actually touch on very similar challenges and opportunities, so I think that's positive that we're really starting to hone in on the key issues. So Global Forest Watch is making major gains in terms of transparency at the production and at the landscape level. But if we want to be able to link the deforestation that we detect on the ground to downstream actors within a supply chain, we do need to make more gains in terms of traceability. And this is a major challenge for many companies. We're seeing varying levels of progress. But I think as those efforts move forward, it'll be really important to link the work that Global Forest Watch is doing in the monitoring space to these emerging traceability initiatives and platforms. Jeff also touched on definitions. For me, in my job, it's problematic that we can't even agree at a global level on how we define forests, let alone deforestation. And now that companies are making these zero deforestation commitments, they're also moving forward to define them in different ways. And while we designed the GFW tool to be neutral and flexible, so if you're using a certain definition, you can tailor the tools to that definition. I do think at the end of the day, these data sets will be even more powerful in terms of driving accountability and driving collective action if we can reach more of a consensus around some of the key terms and how we're setting the goalposts. Finally, a lot of companies are very interested in monitoring social issues as a part of their sustainability commitments, and they want to be able to do this alongside the monitoring environmental issues. But we're facing very fundamental constraints in terms of the robustness of the data and the methods for actually being able to measure and monitor social risk and social impact. It's something we're starting to work on, but there's a lot of work left to be done in this area. And then I also just like to emphasize that these remote sensing approaches to monitoring forests does not actually replace the need to do the on-the-ground verification work, although we like to think that the eyes in the sky can help us inform where we deploy our boots on the ground. But one thing I'm interested in understanding is as companies are going out into the ground and doing these audits, how can we then pull that information back into the GFW system in a transparent way so that we can start to reduce costs, reduce redundancies of efforts that companies are making when they're working in the same landscapes. So again, this is another area that we're starting to do work, but it requires some sort of fundamental rethinking of how we approach verification activities in the field. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Crystal. Our last but not least, Mike Willosen.
Thank you, Alan, and thanks to RFF for hosting. Great room of folks. unlike Crystal and some of the other panelists, I don't work on a specific set of tools or a specific approach. And so what I'd like to do is step back a little bit. As an analyst in the space, I've been working on deforestation reduction and policies specifically for many, many years, and have gotten engaged in corporate approaches, commodity supply chain approaches for the last several years as well. And so what I'd like to do is step back and think a little bit about how the different approaches that are on the table right now to a common set of goals, which primarily in this context are reducing deforestation, so trying to make land use more sustainable. How do these different approaches compare to each other? How do they strengthen each other? And where are they going? So the first one I'd like to talk about briefly is REDD+, which is, in the climate context, an approach to reducing emissions from deforestation and degradation, based potentially on capacity building, foreign assistance, and then ultimately paying for performance in reducing the carbon emissions from deforestation and degradation. So REDD+, over the last 5 to 10 years, has made a transition from what was a project level scale, so an approach of intervening in a specific area with perhaps arbitrary lines on a map and changing the trajectory of the emissions from that project, that area, that specific spot on the earth over the coming years, and comparing what would have happened to what does happen. That REDD+, over the last 5 to 10 years, as I was starting to say, has transitioned from that model up to a model of acting at the jurisdictional scale. So looking at governments, so provinces, states, and ultimately national governments, and measuring progress and also intervening at that scale rather than just at the scale of projects. And that transition is also a transition that we are starting to see in supply chain commodity actions. So there is a discussion, Chris touched on it a little bit, where companies may express a preference for buying or sourcing from an entire jurisdiction that meets criteria, such as being engaged in a REDD program, or having met certain indicators of deforestation reduction potentially, or governance thresholds that they have a handle on their land management. So that transition from the project scale up to the jurisdictional scale is one that I think we're starting to see in the commodity sourcing space and is an interesting thing to watch, and also a linkage. It's a very tight linkage across REDD+ and commodity approaches. I think there's two reasons that this transition was both seen in REDD+ and is now being really thought of seriously in commodity supply chains. First is an issue of leakage. So in REDD+, the idea is that you might protect one spot, but the deforestation is just going to move next door, and we will end up with islands of green and a landscape of deforestation, and we will have ultimately spent a lot of money to lose all the forests or most of the forests in the world. So this leakage is actually something we're starting to hear about from companies in how they're implementing their supply chain actions. So they are concerned in what I would call risk or reputational risk leakage. So a company might certify down to the property or to the production unit that their sources are all deforestation free, and yet an entire product class might be tarnished or tarred as being unacceptable to folks who care about the environment. So Cargill, for example, could have 100% deforestation free palm oil, but if the next door neighbor is chopping down the forest and killing orangutans to produce palm oil, all palm oil is going to seem like a bad and people will start to avoid it. So there is a risk for Cargill in that implementation at the property scale. The second is that I think there has been an increased realization that private sector actors alone on the ground, the people who own or control a spot on the earth, are not going to be sufficient in terms of changing behavior, that you actually need government action to change the behavior. And so if you need government action, then you might need to step back and induce that action at the government scale. So I think there's a natural transition in both cases to that jurisdictional scale. Second point that I'd like to make is that this transition to the jurisdictional scale suggests some rethinking is needed for both models. First, we have clearly understood that pay-for-performance models for RED will not be able to flip individual landowner decisions because it can't pay enough. If you're only paying for the carbon element and you're competing against converting a forest to soy, you are only going to win in the very marginal lands. You are at best going to flip decisions on a few places on Earth. You're not going to actually achieve the transformational change we need. Second, premium is a dirty word to the companies. So if we think that the company supply chains are and the zero deforestation commitments are going to substitute for incentives in an economic sense to change individual landowner behaviors, we are fooling ourselves, because the companies are not going to pay an extra tick. Very unlikely. And that's what you see from existing certification tools, is that only in very specialty products, coffee, tea, products like that that you can trace down to a particular level, label as fair trade, that's the only place you might see some type of tick. But for soy, for palm oil, for products that are mixed into every product that you are buying in the supermarket, you're not going to see that additional payment. So in the economic modeling, we have to think a little bit differently. And that's the last point that I'd like to make. What we need to be targeting are the incentives for decision making at the level of the governments. And we need to think about the economics of the decision makers rather than the economics of the landowners. Because ultimately, this is a governance problem. And as I stand here at Resources for the Future, I can't help but think about another strand of thinking. So if we move from supply chains as one strand of thinking that we started with, we talked a little bit about RED as another way of thinking. A third trend over the last few years has been thinking more and more about natural capital and about green growth. So the idea that landscapes as a whole are providing multiple goods, not just carbon, not just soybeans, but also clean water and also many, many other ecosystem services to the governments. And that leads us to rethink the economics, because what we really need to do is either manage specifically so that we are internalizing all of these other goods that are now external to the decision making, or we need the government decision makers at the levels of jurisdictions, at the levels of countries, to start incorporating all the values that they get from landscapes. Production, carbon, clean water, clean air, they need to be incorporating all those into their decision making. So I will stop there, and I'd love to talk more during the question and answer period. Thanks.
Thanks very much. Thanks so much to our speakers. I think they did a great job not only in making really interesting remarks, but keeping to their time limits, much better than our presidential candidates seem to do. Thank you, Elaine, for being the enforcer. I'd like to ask the panelists to please come up to the front, and we have 15 minutes for questions and answers. And I'd like to abuse my privilege as the moderator to ask the first question, if I may, which is if anyone has any reflections on how some of the demand side policies and the new IT policies, like the one that Crystal described, what role they can play in the post-2020 commitments that folks have made in Paris last year. Would anybody like to start? Christine?
I'd be happy to. Thanks, Alan. And let me just say it's actually really nice to follow such a good set of presentations, because I think everyone else said all the things I wish I could have said. It's very nice to see. Just coming from where I sit, which was part of the negotiating team in Paris, one of the key things that came out of COP21 was a commitment by almost every government on this earth to reduce their emissions over time. Almost every government on earth put in place a commitment to reduce emissions by 2025 or 2030. All of us committed to coming back every 5 years and making those commitments more ambitious. That's huge. Over 120 of those commitments included forests in some way or another. That's also huge. And that's a reflection of the work that everybody in this room has done to build the understanding and the capacity to actually take action in the forest space and to monitor that action. What it also does is create new incentives, I think, for all of us to actually protect forests and to address emissions from forests, agriculture, and other land use. As national governments now have commitments, most of them for the very first time, they will have to be looking at every possible ton of emissions reductions. And when you look at most of the countries that most of us work in, you have emissions coming from forests that represent 40, 60, 80% of the emissions in a country. Governments have to care now. They have to care in a way that they didn't before. And I think you'll start to see that translating into the way we provide partnerships and aid. I think you'll start to see it translating into the way domestic resources are used, domestic decisions are made. Mike talked about the fact that there's all sorts of values coming out of a healthy landscape. Carbon is one of them, but water, food security, soil, rural livelihoods are others that governments are looking at increasingly. And the third thing I think it'll translate into is license to operate. As governments really look for every last ton, they're going to choose who their partners are on the ground. They're going to choose how they want their lands to be used. So I think you're going to see a shift in decision-making coming into the future. I'll leave it at that, but I think we really have a new space now where you have new incentives for governments themselves to care about these issues.
Well, I guess I maybe not so directly, but I'd like to speak to sort of the flip side of the conversation we're having here about keeping standing forests standing, which is the driver of a lot of this, which is the projections about how much more of X, Y, and Z commodities we're going to need by 2050. And those estimates are anywhere from 60% to 100%, depending on the model and the commodity. So the question is, how do we get that much more out of our productive landscapes without cutting down more forests? And I think this is, you know, the other set of conversations that took place at COP in the Global Landscapes Forum and elsewhere around sustainable intensification. And there's some different pieces of that. In the case of agriculture, it's about how to funnel better investment. It's about how to develop better models for extension and smallholder support in a context where those types of programs have been largely gutted in most countries where they're most needed. In the forestry sector, it's a debate about what is the proper role of plantations versus management of natural forests if we want to produce to meet the demand for timber and pulp with a minimum of carbon impacts and footprint on the ground. So that's just the other part I wanted to raise.
Mike?
Thank you. Just one quick note, and that is that the long-term goal that came out of Paris, Chris didn't mention, but these almost every country on Earth also agreed that in the second half of the century, we would seek a balance of sources and sinks. And what that essentially means is that the world has set a net zero target for itself for climate change emissions. And if you look at the options for achieving that, obviously there's a huge amount of work to do to reduce emissions from fossil fuels, and every country is going to have incentives now from their own goals that they set out to do that. But on the flip side, when you look at the last 10% or the last 5% of fossil emissions reductions that you might need to achieve, the expense of doing so goes up and up. So it's the marginal cost issue. And when you look at the future, what's going to happen at that last 5 or 10% is that the sinks are going to become more and more attractive. Because instead of trying to cancel every last ton, we're going to look for ways to sequester that carbon. And so what we just saw from Paris in a second half century net zero target was a long-term strategy of increasing the value of forests. And I think that's a critical point to remember. In restoration and in forest protection, we have the best option out there for achieving net zero.
Great. Thanks a lot. I'd like to open it up to questions from the audience. If you have a question, please line up with the mic. And
hi, Carol Jones from Environmental Law Institute. I'd like to follow up on Michael's point at the end, the role of government, and suggest that there's a role of government in terms of enforcement of the regulations that are in place, and also in terms of bringing environmental liability suits for damages associated with the harm. ELI did a study last year of environmental liability in tropical countries to look specifically at the issue of deforestation. We were working with C4. And we found that laws are basically in place. And in fact, they are being used. Indonesia has a major precedent-setting case in that regard against palm oil plantation destruction of peat forest land. But they're struggling in their subsequent cases. So they need support in terms of furthering that activity. So I'd just like comments on that.
Mike?
Thank you. So I think what I didn't have a chance to talk about is, I think, the long-term vision. And if we are successful in the corporate supply chain action in creating incentives for governments to change their management of land, if we're successful in RED in driving pay-for-performance and building capacity for governments to actually pursue such changes in their land management, then ultimately what we're going to end up with in 20, 30, 50 years is a system where forest countries have set their own goals and essentially put into place laws that govern and manage their lands. And what that means is, to the extent that not every place already has them, and I think what we just heard was that many places already have these laws in place, but the next step after that is going to be essentially making sure that those laws are enforced, are monitored, and ultimately that the buyers of products, coming back to commodities, are not undermining the attempts of countries to manage their own land through law. And we see this right now in the Lacey Act, which Alan mentioned. There's been a global agreement that we should not be undermining countries' attempts to manage their forests by buying illegal timber. And I would look for, in the longer term, similar approaches that we seek to avoid in the buying countries, China, Europe, the US, that we put in place trade policies in the longer term that we are seeking to avoid undermining countries' attempts to manage their forest lands more broadly by doing similar types of things. So I think the law is a critical point, and in the long term, legal frameworks and governance are really what's going to hold the line if we're successful in the near term.
I think you can look only as far as Brazil. Brazil has forest code that's been on the books since 1964. And actually, if you look at it, pure nature, as it was described many times by environmental groups, I keep going back to David Clary, who I've worked with a lot, it's got one of the strongest environmental codes in the country, but in the world. But it was not enforced. They didn't have the capability to enforce it. Out in the Amazon, the local governments, provinces simply didn't have the capacity. You had rampant deforestation, so a voluntary initiative, the soy moratorium, had to be established, I think, to really hold back farmers as it got traction. There was huge political battles in Brazil to try to water it down, dilute it. I'll call Northern Hemisphere interests battling with Southern Hemisphere interests of development. And the private sector there in Brazil many times said, let's just implement the plan, the code, let's get the farmers registered, let's implement what's in the code. No, it is not perfect, but let's get up to speed. And the voluntary initiative around the moratorium and putting farmers on blacklist has held, and it's holding, and it's been extended 6 years in a row. In the meantime, the Brazil government has slowly been engaged, has built its enforcement capability. It's still not perfect. And there are still multiple initiatives pecking away at this forest code. And we just are seeing now in the last 6 months to a year the development of the Brazil coalition, which is really driven more by Brazil interests, Brazil private sector, Brazil civil society, to sort of take ownership of the issue. So a great case example.
Sir?
No, thank you. Al Sample with George Mason University. And I wanted to follow up on your comment a moment ago, Michael, about the importance of carbon sinks and maintaining, perhaps even enhancing those carbon sinks. And I think also maybe to some of the points Stephen made about the role of governance. A lot of the analysis that I've been doing lately is focused on U.S. forests and what role the carbon sink is going to play in meeting our own commitments. And, you know, we've had a number of studies done over the years that provide a whole list of things that we can do in the forest sector to mitigate climate change, increase carbon removal. One by one, you know, they've just been knocked down. Well, we can't really do much about deforestation because, at least here in the United States, you know, that's interfering with economic development. Cities can't grow. You know, we can't, you know, we need those subdivisions. We need those shopping malls, you know. Afforestation, you know, you pretty quickly run into a conflict with the ag sector, you know, afforestation of marginal lands. They look at those, and those aren't marginal lands. Those are areas that we need to expand crop and pasture land in response to fluctuations in agricultural commodity markets. So that one's knocked down. So every one of these, and bioenergy, you know, that's probably got the, you know, the greatest pushback, you know, using wood biomass as a substitute for fossil fuels. Sounds great at the surface, but once you dig into it, there's some real problems with it. So one of the few things that's really left is reforestation. And I was kind of surprised to look at the amount of non-stocked forest land in the United States, where on both private lands and on public lands, where there really is no incentive, there's no market incentive for the private sector to reforest those lands, and there's no policy incentive for reforestation of those public lands. So, you know, when I think about what all of you work on at the global scale, and the difficulty of overcoming barriers like that in a country like the United States, it must be mind-boggling to think about what kind of a barrier that is in working with tropical forests in, you know, nations with weak governance. So I guess there's a question in there. Sorry. So I guess I'm asking, so do you see a role for, you know, not just slowing the rate of deforestation, but looking at some of these areas that you can identify, and now with great specificity with tools like WRIs, to actually identify areas that may have been deforested in the past, you know, in the tropics where shifting agriculture has been one of the major drivers. You know, maybe these are areas where the farmers have now moved on and it's no longer in agriculture, and those represent opportunities for reforestation and actually strengthening the carbon sink. Is that part of the strategy?
Maybe wearing two hats, I might take a quick shot at that. Wearing my hat working internationally, it very much is actually part of the discussion. And I think we focused here on deforestation, which was the topic of the panel. But Red Plus, which Michael mentioned quite eloquently, the plus part of that is actually conservation and reforestation. So it very much does fit into the schemes that we put in place internationally. It fits into the strategies a lot of developing countries are putting into place. It's also, there are a number of big international initiatives like the Bond Challenge, which is an initiative on forest restoration specifically. There are a couple big other global partnerships now focusing on forest restoration, ecosystem restoration, which have been, I think, gaining a lot of attention. WRI is actually keenly involved in some of those. Domestically, and I work at the State Department, so this isn't my role, but in the US, certainly we have the same challenges every country has. And we do have a bond challenge commitment of 15 million hectares of restoration. But I think more importantly, as we look to our own climate commitments in the short term and in the long term, as you note, the sink is going to be increasingly important. We do have a forest sink right now. Our forests offset somewhere around 14, 15, 16% of our emissions each year. The challenge is for us to keep that sink stable and then to expand it. There is actually a lot of work being done in the US to look at how we do that, both with public and private incentives. And I won't take a lot of time now, but I'd encourage you to look at the USDA building blocks for climate smart agriculture and forestry, which have a whole series of both public and private programs targeting exactly that.
Okay. We have time for one quick last question, please.
Yes, Rodney Schmidt with Rights and Resources Initiative. Just an observation that I'm hoping some panel members would like to comment on. In the some 191 statements of commitments of that countries have submitted following the Paris COP agreement, the INDCs, of those 191, if I have my figures right, 11, a total of 11 have a clear commitment to a forest strategy as part of their emissions reductions program, and a mere 6 have a commitment to including forest communities and indigenous peoples and titling local community titling of forest lands. I'm not sure, well, it seems fairly clear what that means at this stage as to how seriously governments are taking forests as part of their plan, but I wonder if you would care to comment.
I'm not going to refute your numbers, so I definitely have not read all 191 of the INDCs. But generally speaking, I don't think we have a shortage of commitments right now between the New York Declaration and the commitments that individual companies are making. The ambition is out there. But I think for me, one of the big challenges, I'm going to continue harping on this issue of definitions. You know, when it comes to greenhouse gas emissions, we can all agree that a ton is a ton. But we still have no ability to agree on what a forest is and what counts as deforestation. So even though our ability to monitor forests is improving, and we can now see from satellites when trees are being cut down, getting into a conversation about whether that tree constituted a forest and whether cutting it down constituted deforestation becomes this horribly political debate. And until we can have more clarity, there's just going to be no way to have accountability around these commitments and have any understanding about whether or not they're being implemented. So I think we need to push forward on this, you know, creating more consensus around what we mean by forest and deforestation.
I just and sort of back that up. The definition question is something that Crystal and I have been involved in some conversations about. But I think whatever the numbers are, and you can go back to the reforestation comment earlier about helping people reforest, because some of the laws in Paraguay or in Brazil, you know, actually give people the right to convert a certain percentage of their land, and today they may have over-converted and they are on a blacklist. And how do you help people get off the blacklist by helping them move? So we have to move, I think, as a collective away from the gotcha mentality that says, aha, you haven't done anything on your strategy tomorrow. What can we do to help you put that strategy in place? What can we do to make a definition that brings more people into the tent to get started? Because I think you have a lot of cultural variability out there with the countries, the institutions, the private sector companies that have very different cultures around, let's call it activism in this kind of nature. And they don't want to be called out in conflict that they're exposed. But the ambition is there, the energy and passion is there. But we've got to bring people in, make them a discussor.
Okay. Yeah. Just real quick, Mike, please.
Yeah, very quickly. I think the INDCs, the numbers you put out are correct. Most countries don't want to be more specific than they have to be. And so I think what we are seeing with the number of countries with explicit plans or explicit targets in the forest sector is the exception rather than the rule. The U.S. doesn't say what it will go after in which sector. Why would we expect a developing country to do the same? All countries want as much flexibility as they can. On the other hand, if you look at the red, the venues for countries to act and make progress on reducing emissions from deforestation, there are dozens and dozens of countries participating in UN systems, in World Bank systems, and in many other contexts developing their plans and land use strategies. Almost all of them include approaches to indigenous peoples and local communities and how those people can be part of that strategy, not a victim of those strategies. And I think we need to continue to monitor and make sure that that really happens and is not just happy talk. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm sorry we're out of time, but I want to thank you for attending, and I'd like to invite you to join me in thanking our panelists for a really great discussion.